Kindly read now number 20. Read it. Resistance of a metallic wire by formula rho into L by A, just multiply numerator and denominator by L, then rho as it is, L into L, that is L square A into L, rho into L square as it is, but what is cross sectional area into length of a wire? It will give you, that product will give you volume of that wire, correct? Let it be capital V. Now tell me, this volume V I want to replace by density and mass, then you know density is mass upon volume, density is mass upon volume. Normally for density we use the symbol rho, but rho is here used for resistivity, so I am just putting new symbol, density, D symbol, okay, it is mass upon volume. Then what will be volume? Mass upon density. So this volume can be replaced by mass upon density, M upon D, denominators, denominator will become numerator. So, D I am writing here, correct. So, resistance formula in terms of rho L D and M would appear like this, rho L square D upon M, rho L square D upon M. This is electrical resistance, this is electrical resistivity, this is length of a metallic wire, this is density of material of that metallic wire, and M is the mass of that wire, okay. Now tell me, here you are given three wires made up of same material. So, same material means this resistivity will be constant and this density also will be constant. For all the three wires, rho and D values are same, okay. So, if rho and D are constants right now, you may remove that constant part, then relation between R, L and M you can write this way, R proportional to L square upon M. R proportional to L square upon M, correct. But because we are given three wires whose resistances are to be compared, then you must go for the proportion. How would you write proportion of resistances of those three wires? R1 is to R2 is to R3. This is how you must write, R1 is to R2 is to R3, correct. The way you are taking proportion of resistances on the left side, on the right side you should take the proportion of this ratio L square upon M for each wire. For first wire you may write L1 square upon M1, here it is L1 square upon M1, correct. For second wire L2 square upon M2, for third wire L3 square upon M3, and all these ratios will be in the similar, in the same proportion as the resistances R1, R2, R3 are, okay. So, you may write mathematically, R1 is to R2 is to R3 equals to L1 square upon M1 is to L2 square upon M2 is to L3 square upon M3. Now tell me, the proportion of lengths of the three wires are given to you with the value 1 is to 3 is to 5, 1 is to 3 is to 5. In short, if L1 is taken as 1 unit, then this L2 can be taken as 3 unit and L3 can be taken as 5 units, okay, like that. So, proportion of lengths of the three wires are 1 is to 3 is to 5, then in place of L1 you may write 1, in place of L2 you may write 3, and in place of L3 you should write 5, correct. Now, what about proportion of masses? Proportion of masses they have given as 5 is to 3 is to 1, that is in place of M1 you must write 5, in place of M2 you must write 3, and in place of M3 you must write 1, 5 is to 3 is to 1, correct. Now tell me, simplify, this is 1 by 5 is 2, 3 square is 9, 9 by 3 that is 3, 5 square is 24 upon 1 that is 25, correct. Of course, this answer is also correct, but this answer is not given in the same form in the options, okay. So, we have to see out of the given options which option matches with our answer. For that what you should do now, you can multiply all these values by 5. If you do that, here it is 1, 5 3s are 15 and 5 25s are 125, correct? This is the correct answer and it is there in the option, okay? So your final answer would be 1:15:125. You may have a question, sir, can we just multiply only on right hand side and that will do? Yes, because this is not equality, this is the proportion, and that is why you can multiply. See, for example, if R1 is taken as 1/5, correct, and then R2 will be 3 unit. For example, see what does it mean? If R1 is 1/5, then R2 will be 3. So if R1 upon R2, the ratio you are taking R1 upon R2, then it will be 1/5/3. And in that ratio, 1/5/3, you may multiply by any number in numerator and denominator, will do no problem. For example, here we have multiplied by 5. So in any ratio, if you are multiplying numerator also by 5, denominator also by 5, then 5/5 is going to get cancelled. So it won't affect the ratio, okay? That is why you can do only on the right hand side also, because this is the proportion. Got it? Fine. So finally, the proportion of resistances of given 3 wires will be R1:R2:R3=1:15:125. And now tell me, what does this mean? If resistance of first wire is taken as 1 unit, then resistance of second wire will be 15 times the resistance of first wire. So in that case, suppose they give resistance of first wire, suppose 4 ohms, suppose. Then what will be resistance of second wire? 15 times 4 ohm, that is 15 into 4, that is 60 ohm. Got it? Like that, please. Kindly read now statement of number 21. Read it, come on. Can you recall this formula? VL1=E ρ/R+L ρ+r. Outside the bracket, it is small L1. Can you recall this formula? Tell me, what is it about? You must remember the formula for finding potential difference between two points separated by distance L1 along the current carrying potentiometer wire. And that formula was same. VL1=E ρ/R+L ρ+r, outside the bracket small L1. Give me identification of each symbol. This is the EMF of a battery connected in primary circuit. Right now they have given 3 volt. This is resistance per unit length of potentiometer wire, that is total resistance upon total length of the potentiometer wire. Total resistance of potentiometer wire they have given 20 ohm, divided by total length of potentiometer wire they have given 10 meter. What about capital R? It is the external resistance connected in series with the potentiometer wire, or it is a resistance taken out in the resistance box connected with potentiometer wire. At present they have given 10 ohm. Capital L into rho will give you total resistance of potentiometer wire, which they have given 20 ohm. This is the internal resistance of a battery connected in primary circuit of a potentiometer. At present they have not given any internal resistance, meaning thereby we should take this internal resistance to be 0. And what is this length L1? It is that length of potentiometer wire which can balance this much potential difference. And that length they have given 30 centimeter. But because all these values you are putting in SI unit system, this length must be placed in meter. 30/100, that is 0.3 meter. That's why I'm writing here 0.3 meter. Now simplify, final answer is 0.06 volt. SI unit of potential difference or voltage is volt. Just put symbol capital V and don't put any full stop, please. Come on, read now statement of number 22. Read it. Look. What was the formula for finding internal resistance of a cell connected in secondary circuit of a potentiometer wire in the potentiometer circuit? Come on. If you are finding the internal resistance of first cell in the theoretical part, we had learned the formula. It was this: small r1 equals to capital R1 into bracket L1 upon L1 dash minus 1. Remembered? Just give me identification. What is small r1? Internal resistance of first cell connected in secondary circuit of a potentiometer. Correct? What about capital R1? It is the resistance connected in parallel with that cell whose internal resistance is to be found out. What is L1? It is length of a potentiometer wire required to balance this EMF of first cell. Correct? And this L1 dash is the length of potentiometer wire required to balance the terminal voltage of first cell. Correct? Fine. Now tell me, which are the values right now? Come on, capital R1 is the resistance connected in parallel with that cell whose internal resistance is found out. They have given 5 ohm. What about L1? It is the length of a potentiometer wire required to balance the EMF of first cell connected in secondary circuit. Right now they have given 60 centimeter. What is L1 dash? It is the length of potentiometer wire required to balance the terminal voltage of first cell connected in the secondary circuit. Right now they have given 50 centimeter minus 1. Correct? Now simplify. Answer is 1 ohm. And now accordingly they may ask internal resistance of second cell connected in the secondary circuit of a potentiometer. In that case you may use the formula small r2 equals to capital R2 into L2 upon L2 dash minus 1. Correct? The same formula we had learned in the theoretical part. Correct? Fine. Kindly read now statement of number 23. Read it? Come on. For a mixed connection of batteries, what was the total current passing through the external resistance? It was effective or equivalent EMF divided by equivalent resistance, which is capital R plus small r eq, that is summation of external resistance and equivalent internal resistances. Okay? Equivalent internal resistance. Fine. Now, what is this equivalent EMF right now? In case of mixed connection of batteries, this equivalent EMF is equivalent EMF obtained out of any one row. Correct? Here in one row there is only one cell. In one row there is only one cell. So equivalent EMF will be simply E. Correct? This capital R as it is. This is equivalent internal resistance of given mixed connection of the batteries. Here in one row only one electric cell having internal resistance small r, and such n number of rows are connected in parallel. If identical resistances are connected in parallel, what is equivalent resistance? Single divided by number. Single resistance is small r and number is n. That's why it is r upon n. Okay? Here n is right now number of rows. Okay? In the theoretical part, number of rows was shown by symbol small m. Right now it is small n. That is a mere change of symbol. That's all. Now just simplify. N will be multiplied here, and if you take n as LCM, then n will go up in the numerator. So it is n into E upon n into capital R plus small r. So this much will be current passing through external resistance. Read now statement of number 24. Read it. Look. Resistance of conducting wire, here metallic wire, it is rho into L by A, rho as it is, come on, numerator and denominator I am just multiply by capital A, that is cross section area of a metallic wire. Come on, here when you multiply by A, it is A into L, here A into A, that is A square. Now this rho as it is, cross sectional area into length will give you volume of a wire, let it be capital V divided by A square. Tell me, I told you in the past in such similar problems, whenever you stretch any wire, what happens? The type of material does not change, so rho is constant. Whenever you stretch any wire, what will happen? Volume will remain constant, because you know density is mass upon volume. When the material is not changing, density will be constant. And while stretching the wire, neither you are adding some mass to that, nor you are removing some mass, so mass is also constant. Density equals to mass upon volume, density is constant, mass is constant, so volume has to be constant. Come on, rho and V, they are constants. And so, if you remove that constant part, R will be proportional to 1 upon A square. R will be proportional to 1 upon A square, that is, this resistance is inversely proportional to square of cross sectional area, correct? Now, because it is inverse proportionality, 1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, R1 upon R2 will be equal to A2 square upon A1 square. Come on, what is this second value of cross section area? They have given 1 upon N times the initial cross section area, that is 1 upon N into A1, that is A1 upon N. So, this A2 is A1 upon N, correct? A1 upon N, nth part of A1, nth part of A1, or 1 upon n times a1, it is one and same, it is a1 upon n, it is a square upon a1 square, correct? Now tell me, this will be a1 square upon a1 square getting cancelled, and then left is 1 upon n square, 1 upon n square, correct? In textbook, in this statement, by mistake they have given here n greater than 0, no, it is not correct, they should have given n greater than 1. Because n greater than 0 means you may take 0.1 also, correct? You may take 0.1 also. If you take 0.1 which is greater than 0 here, then tell me A1 upon 0.1 will be 10 into A1. 10 into A1 means when you stretch the wire, you know wire will become thinner, cross section area will decrease, and according to the given statement, it will become 10 times, cross section area will increase. No, it will not happen so. The wire will not become thicker, it will become on the contrary thinner, okay? So, it is not right, it should be n greater than 1, okay, fine. Now tell me, find out R2 from here, R2 will be n square into R1, R2 will be n square into R1, okay, fine. So, this value of resistance in terms of initial resistance has come out to be n square times, where n is, I am reminding you once again, greater than 1, okay, because when you stretch the wire, naturally the length will increase, cross section level will decrease, and then it will become some part of initial cross sectional area where n is greater than 1, okay, fine. Come on my dears, kindly read this statement of MCQ number 25 in the exercise. Read it, look, electrical power spent in the bulb is given by this formula I square R, that is current square into resistance, correct, fine. For a given bulb, its resistance is constant, so you can think of relation between P and I as P varies as I square, correct. When P varies as I square, it is the relation of direct proportionality, and there you can write mathematically P1 upon P2 equals to I1 square upon I2 square. Direct proportionality then 1, 2, 1, 2, just remember P1 upon P2 equals to I1 square upon I2 square, correct? Now tell me, what did I tell last time? Whenever they talk in terms of percentage, original value you must assume 100 units, okay? Here current is increased by 1%, then original current I must assume 100 unit. So I1 I am taking 100 unit. If it is so, then what is second value of current? It is greater than first value of current by 1%, correct? What is 1% of 100 units? It is simply 1, but that much is the increase. So 100 plus 1, it will be 101. So new current you should take 101, okay? And it's a square, okay? Just to find out percentage very easily, we always assume original value to be 100 units, okay? Fine. Now tell me, if you simplify this, then you will get value of P2 in terms of P1 as 1.0201, that many times P1, okay? Naturally, when current will increase, come on, power will also increase. Then what is the increase in power? Bigger power minus smaller power, that is P2 minus P1. P2 is 1.0201 P1 minus P1 as it is. Now, P1, P1 you can take common inside the bracket 1.0201 minus 1, that is 0.0201, okay? But because you want increase in power in percentage, you must multiply this value by 100, correct? And if you multiply by 100%, it will be 2.01%, okay? So, increase in power in this case will be 2.01% P1. This much percentage you are supposed to take of initial power, correct? Fine. My dears, here if you adopt the method of derivative, then there you have studied the formula dp upon p into 100% equals to 2 into di upon I into 100%. That is, percentage increase in power will be 2 times percentage increase in the current. Here percentage increase in the current is 1% multiplied by 2, then you made the answer 2 into 1%, that is 2%. But accurate answer is this, 2.01%, correct? And that accurate answer we are just bringing here according to this method. This is not the method of derivative, okay? Please. Sometimes they may just try to cheat you, you know. They may give both the values. In the options, they may give you both the values, 2% also, and the most accurate value also, that is this one, okay? At that time, this will be your final answer, okay? Take care. Kindly read now statement of number 26. Read it, look. Here we are given parallel connection of resistances, but in the upper branch we have two resistances connected in series. One is 4 ohm, another is 5 ohm, correct? In the lower branch we have resistance 10 ohm. Suppose I indicate this resistance by symbol R1, this by symbol R2, correct? Now, what is given to us in the statement? When current is passed through this parallel combination, then because of current passing through this resistance, here in 1 second, 10 calorie amount of joules heat is generated in this resistance, okay? If it is so, at the same time, how much heat will be generated per second in this 4 ohm resistance, that is what we have to find out, okay? Here I am showing you very easy way to find out the answer. First of all, you simply make the addition of given resistance values, 10 plus 4 plus 5, that is 19, okay? Now you please take total current which is passing through this parallel combination as 19i, correct? Why you have to do like that? I am showing you the reason for that. When 19i amount of current comes at this junction, out of that 10i amount of current will be diverted here, and remaining current 19i minus 10i, that is 9i current will be diverted here, correct? Now you may ask me, sir, how we will come to know that what part of this will be diverted here, what part of this will be diverted here? Simple. What is the resistance in this branch? 10, okay? Then 19 minus 10, that will be 9 unit. So 9I current will pass through this, correct? And what is the total distance here? 5 plus 4, that is 9, 19 minus 9, 19 minus 9, that is 10, 10I unit of current will pass through this branch, correct? But why it happens like that? Because you know the resistances connected in parallel will have equal potential differences, correct? You just find out potential difference. Potential difference is current into resistance. What is current here? 10I. What is total resistance here? 5 plus 4, that is 9 ohm. 9 ohm into 10I. 9 into 10I. 9 into 10I. How much it is? 90I, correct? Here also, what is the resistance? 10. And what is the current? 9I. Take the multiplication, it will be 90I, correct? So here also potential difference is 90I, here also potential difference is 90I, potential differences are same, okay? So this is how division of current will take place, provided total current you assume 19I. You may assume any value of total current, no problem, but just to solve the this problem, just to get the answer easily, I am just showing you one idea, okay? Now, because you are given Joulean power in this resistance, let us talk about this resistance first. What is the expression for Joulean power? P equals to current square into resistance. I am writing here P2 equals to I2 square into R2, correct? This is Joulean power in this second resistance. They have given 10 calorie per second. This I2 is the current passing through this resistance, which is 9I. So I2 is 9I, it is a square multiplied by resistance. Resistance is here 10 ohm, correct? This 10 and 10 will cancel, and here 9 square is 81, let it go down in the left hand side, then I square you will get 1 upon 81, 1 upon 81. Do not write any unit here, okay, because this 19I we have selected in the arbitrary unit, in the arbitrary unit. Here this current is not necessary to be in ampere, okay. Suppose you write here ampere square, suppose, and then if you calculate the amount of joules heat developed in this per second, then it will not be according to the statement, okay. So do not do that, do not write any unit here, okay, fine. Now similar to this formula, I have written here formula for this resistance, come on, Joulean power P equals to I square R, like that, I have written here P1 equals to I1 square R1, I1 square R1. What is I1? Current passing through this resistance, correct? And because these two are connected in series, same current will pass through both of them. Right now we require current passing through this, it is I1, it is 10I. So I1 is 10I, it is a square multiplied by R1. R1 is this resistance 4 ohm, correct? So this is now 10 square is 100 into I square into 4, but I square is 1 upon 81. I square is 1 upon 81, correct? And now if you simplify, answer is 4.938 calorie per second, but this answer is nearly equal to 5 calorie per second, okay? They ask about approximate answer and it is 5 calorie per second, but now just be careful. They have asked this amount of joules heat developed in this resistance per 1 second, okay? That is why we have found out in calorie per second, but they may ask that Joulean power in watt. If they ask so, then what the change you will make? You know 1 calorie is 4.186 joule. So you will multiply this value by 4.186 and that many joule per second that is watt, okay? They may ask about this resistance, correct? They may ask amount of joules it developed in this resistance per second. In that case, what you will do? Here, you will write instead of 4, you will write 5 ohm. That is all. Got it? Once again, let me remind you, you can just think of any value of total current, but just to have divisions of that total current easily, I just suggested you one idea. In that, what you are supposed to do? Just make the summation of values of resistances and that many I you take as total current, okay? And then this plus this, that is 9, 19 minus 9, so 10 parts of that total current will pass through this and remaining part of that current will pass through this. It is very easy, okay, fine. Now read the statement of number 27. Read it. Look. We are given two bulbs with this power rating, 220 volt, 100 watt. Now, what do you mean by this power rating? If you purchase any electric bulb from the market, then on the surface of that glass bulb, it is so printed about two values, and that written information about two values itself is known as power rating. Which are the two values mentioned in that power rating? One is the maximum voltage which you can apply across the filaments of that bulb, and second is the maximum power spent at the application of maximum voltage. When you apply this much maximum voltage, at that time power consumed in that bulb will be 100 watt, like that, okay. So, mention of two values, one is maximum voltage, another is maximum power, is known as power rating, okay. Now, here we have two bulbs with the same power rating, and first we connect them in series, correct. Earlier in the illustrative numericals, we had obtained one formula for finding total power consumed in case of series connection. And what was that formula? 1 upon Ps equals to 1 upon P1 plus 1 upon P2. 1 upon Ps equals to 1 upon P1 plus 1 upon P2 for a series connection of two bulbs, okay, fine. Now, P1 and P2 both are same, both of them are equal to 100 watt. So, now this summation will be 2 upon 100, take reciprocal, Ps will be 100 upon 2, that is 50 watt. Correct. So, here in case of series connection of identical bulbs, remember the total power consumed will be single power value divided by number of bulbs, single divided by number, single divided by number, got it. What about now parallel connection? Now, they are connecting both the bulbs in parallel, fine. Now, what was the law for finding the total power consumed in the parallel connection of bulbs? It was PP equals to P1 plus P2, PP equals to P1 plus P2, correct. The same result we had obtained earlier in the illustrative numericals, got it. Now, these two powers are each 100 watt, 100 plus 100, that is 2 into 100. Why I am writing like this? So that you will come to know single power multiplied by number. Here single power divided by number, here single power multiplied by number, okay. So, final answer here it will be 200 watt, got it, fine. Now, my dears, we begin with a new section, that is section D. It is about short questions which are given in the exercise in the textbook, okay. But among all these short questions, majority we have discussed in the theoretical part of this chapter, that is in section A. So, we are not wasting time once again. I am not just repeating those question answers. But the questions which are little bit new, which may you may find little bit difficult, only those short questions I am going to discuss now, okay, in this section. Let us see about those short questions which are so far not discussed. Come on, such a question number 2 is there. So, better you read the statement of question number 2. Read it, come on. Magnitude of charge of one electron is E, then for such n number of electrons, what will be total magnitude of electric charge? It will be n into E, correct. For one electron, if it is E, for n electrons, it will be n into E, and let it be total charge capital Q, correct. Now, this charge is given to you 1 nano coulomb, 1 nano coulomb, nano means 10 raised to minus 9, correct. You must have remembered the table of decimal sub multiples, remembered from 11th standard, deci, centi, milli, micro, nano, pico, femto, etto, zepto, yocto, in that nano means 10 raised to minus 9, come on. So, 1 nano coulomb is the total charge given to you, nano coulomb you must convert into coulomb, because coulomb is the SI unit of electric charge. Multiply 10 raised to minus 9, this total number of electrons we require to find out. Magnitude of charge of 1 electron is 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb, correct. Find out capital N, answer is 6.25 into 10 raised to 9, okay. Kindly read now statement of number 3. Read it, come on. See, whenever it is given to you that current is passing through the battery, unless and until it is mentioned that that battery is getting charged up, you by default should take its discharge condition, correct? Whenever say that current is passing through a battery, you must consider discharging condition of the battery, okay? If it is charging condition, they will definitely mention, specifically they will write that battery is getting charged up, okay? If it is not mentioned so, you must take it discharged condition of a battery, correct? Fine. For a discharging condition of the battery, what was the relation between terminal voltage and EMF? I told you V equals to E minus IR, V equals to E minus IR, correct? What is terminal voltage right now? 2 volt, EMF we want to find out, current is 0.5 ampere, internal resistance they have given 0.2 ohm. Find out answer of E comes out to be 2.1 that many volt, correct? Come on, read now statement of question number 6. Ready it? Look, you know this formula, I equals to A into V D into N into E, correct? What is A? It is cross sectional area. For a wire, when you take cross sectional area, it will come out to be a circular area, and for a area of a circle, you must remember the formula pi into radius square, pi into radius square, correct? Now here, current I is given in both the cases same. And because the type of material remains same, the free electron number density is constant, magnetic charge of one electron is as such constant only, pi is also constant. In short, here in the present case, this multiplication R square into V D must be taken as a constant. So, R square into V D is constant, correct? And this means mathematically R 1 square V D 1 equals to R 2 square V D 2. What is the first value of radius of cross section? They are given as R. First value of drift velocity they have given as V, second value of radius of cross section they have given as 2R, and second value of drift velocity we require to find out, okay. And now R square will cancel, 2 square is 4, 4 you can take down, so V D 2 will be V by 4, V by 4, correct, fine. Read now about question number 8. Read it, come on. Whenever we stretch any metallic wire, the relation between its electrical resistance and its length, you must remember, so far such questions we have discussed nearly 2 to 3 times. Come on, R proportional to L square. Whenever we stretch any metallic wire, remember the relation R proportional to L square. Because it is direct proportionality, then 1 to 1 to, correct? So, from here R 1 upon R 2 will be equal to L 1 square upon L 2 square. Now, this initial resistance they have given 10 ohm, final resistance they require 1000 ohm. Now, this L 1 square upon L 2 square as it is, come on, 10 upon 1000 that is 1 upon 100, take square root on both the sides, you will get L 1 upon L 2 equal to 1 upon 10. Find out L 2, it will be 10 L 1, L 2 equals to 10 L 1. Okay. So, if their question is that final length should be how many times initial length, then this is the answer. It should be 10 times initial length. It should be 10 times initial length. But if their question is how much should be increase in the length, then that increase in the length I am showing you. Can you write 10 L1 as Can you write 10 L1 as L1 plus 9 L1? Yes, we can write 10 L1 equals to L1 plus 9 L1. L1 amount of length already you had, and plus whatever is the increase, increase is 9 L1. So, if they are asking about increase in the length, it should be 9 times the initial length. But if they are asking what should be the final length should be 10 times initial length. So, read the question carefully and then try to answer accordingly, please. Read about now question number 15. Ready it? Look, they are asking about examples of ohmic laws. See, whenever electrical energy is getting transformed in the form of heat energy in any resistance, which is called ohmic resistance, that energy wasted in the form of heat energy is known as ohmic laws. Get it? Whenever electrical energy is getting transformed into heat energy in some resistance, that wasted amount of energy is known as ohmic loss. Okay? For example, when a current is passing through any battery, that current definitely passes through its internal resistance also. Correct? At that time, whatever Julian power is generated in that internal resistance, it is nothing but wasted power. We call this loss as ohmic loss. Correct? Fine. Then second example you can take of electric motor. At our home, we are using electric motor to fetch water from lower tank to upper tank. Which power we are supplying to that motor? Electrical power. But unfortunately, its majority part is converted into joules heat. Correct? And then that heat energy which raises the temperature of that coil which is used inside the motor, unnecessarily that energy is wasted, we call it ohmic loss. Very little energy is utilized in the form of mechanical energy to fetch the water from lower height to greater height. Simple? Fine. Third example we take about transformer. About transformer you will be taught in the fourth semester. Okay? There we are using two coils, one is called primary coil, another is called secondary coil. And through those two coils, whenever current is passed, some amount of joules heat is generated. Again, it is a wastage of energy, and that energy which is wasted, this phenomenon is known as ohmic loss. Okay? Then we talk about cables. See, at electrical power station, we produce a power with a very high rate, and that huge amount of electrical power requires to be sent to a remote place, which is very distant place, and then we use cables, but whenever electrical power is transmitted through the cables, at that time in those long cables, lot of heat is generated, and again it is a loss of energy in the form of heat energy, which is also called ohmic loss. Okay? Of course, we can minimize that, but whatever loss is there, it is called ohmic loss. Okay? Fine. Now, my dears, we begin with new section, that is section E. And that is EN, that is exercise numericals. Okay? Last section of this chapter, exercise numericals. Can you read the statement of first exercise numerical in the textbook? Read it? Look. You know current formula? It is I equals to Q upon T. When this formula is to be used? Whenever you are talking about unidirectional current and whenever you are talking about a current which is having constant magnitude. Such current is known as steady current. So, in case of steady current, you can use this formula I equals to Q by T. If this charge is equivalent to n number of electrons, then you can write Q equals to n into E. Here also we written Q equals to N into E, correct? Same formula here also, Q equals to N into E, this T as it is. Now, what have they asked? Number of electrons per 1 second, that is total number of electrons divided by total time. In short, they require the ratio N upon T. Just make it subject of the equation, N upon T will be I upon E, correct? What is this current? 10 microampere converted into ampere multiplied 10 raised to minus 6. What is magnitude of charge of 1 electron? It is 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb. Simplify, answer is 6.25 into 10 raised to 13, that many electron per second. Okay? Don't write this word in plural, no, write it in singular only. It is a rule, whenever you mention any unit, the value you must write with the unit in the singular form. Okay? Don't write electrons, you write only electron, that many electron per second, got it? Now, in the second case, still the current value remains same, that is why I am using once again same symbol, here also I, here also I. But from here you can see, if this is constant, then if you change the time, naturally corresponding charge amount will also get changed. Or you may speak conversely, if you change the amount of charge, then corresponding time interval will change, simple. So, here I am writing once again I, but instead of Q I am writing Q dash, instead of T I am writing T dash, correct? Find out Q dash, it is I into T dash, come on, what is this I? That current is given to you, 10 microampere, microampere converted into ampere multiplied to 10 raised to minus 6, and this new time is given to you 1 minute is 60 second, okay? Simplify, answer is 6 into 10 raised to minus 4, that many coulomb. But mind well, this is the charge of electrons, and because electrons have negative charge, this amount of charge must be shown with a negative sign, that is why I am putting here negative sign. Okay? So, your final answer should be Q dash equals to minus 6 into 10 raised to minus 4, that many coulomb. Okay? Fine. Kindly read now statement of number 2. Read it, come on. Whenever any charge performs uniform circular motion in some circle of some radius and with some orbital speed, at that time you can think of relation between linear speed and angular speed. What was that? As you studied in 11th standard, V equals to R omega, V equals to R omega, where omega is called angular speed or angular frequency, which is frequency multiplied by 2 pi radian, correct? Here f means frequency of revolution, how many revolutions are finished in unit time, that value is known as frequency of revolution shown by symbol f. Okay? Now, find out f from here, it is v upon 2 pi r, let it come down, v upon 2 pi r. See, previously we had discussed about this formula and I told you to remember this formula, I equals to f into e, remembered? Actually general formula was I equals to f into q, where q is a circulating charge which is circulating with frequency f, correct? But here the circulating charge is electron, so I am writing I equals to f into e, correct? Fine. Remember this formula about the current setup in the circular path in which this some charge is circulating with this frequency of revolution. Okay? Fine. Now, this f is v upon 2 pi r, e as it is, what is this v? Orbital speed, and that orbital speed they have given in the statement about electron, how much? E square upon h cross. This is new symbol for you, it is to be pronounced as h cross or h cut, h cross or h cut. And what is its meaning, what is its interpretation? H cross or h cut means h upon 2 pi, h upon 2 pi, where small h is called Planck's constant. Its value is 6.625 into 10 raised to minus 34 joule into second. I repeat, this orbital speed they have given in the statement E square upon h cross. What is this h cross or h cut? It is h upon 2 pi, where h is Planck's constant with value 6.625 into 10 raised to minus 34 joule into second, correct? Fine. What is E? That everybody knows, magnitude of charge of 1 electron upon 2 pi as it is. What is this? Radius of circular path, they have given h cross the square upon m e square, h cross the square upon m e square, come on, into E. Now simplify this. This h cross will come down, h cross into h cross square will be h cross cube, 2 pi as it is. This m e square will go up, m I have already written here, e square into e, altogether it is e raised to 5, correct? Now m e raised to 5 as it is, 2 pi as it is. What about h cross? Just now I told you it is h upon 2 pi, it is a cube. Now simplify, this m e raised to 5 I have written as it is. This 2 pi cube will be 8 pi cube, let it go up in the numerator, I am writing here 8 pi cube. This 2 pi also as it is, simplify now, 2 4s are 8, so here it is 4, pi cube upon pi will be pi square in the numerator, m e raised to 5 upon h cube, m e raised to 5 upon h cube, correct. So this is the required formula for the current setup in the circular path because of circular motion of electron with this much orbital speed in a circular orbit of this much orbital radius, correct? Fine. The current formula which we require is this, 4 pi square m e raised to 5 upon h cube, got it? Read now statement of number 3, this example is bit long, read the statement carefully 2 times. Come on, voltage applied is equal to, according to Ohm's law, current multiplied by resistance, V equals to I R, but I as it is and resistance of a metallic wire is rho into L by A, correct? We are given all these values, we can find out this voltage, come on, current is 1 ampere, resistivity they have given 1.7 into 10 raised to minus 8 ohm into meter. Length of the copper wire they have given 10 centimeter, 10 centimeter convert into meter, 10 upon 100 that is 0.1 meter. What about cross section area? If it is 1 millimeter square convert into meter square, 1 millimeter square, millimeter itself is 10 raised to minus 3 meter, its square will be 10 raised to minus 6 meter square. So whenever any area is given to you in millimeter square, you want to convert into meter square, just multiply by 10 raised to minus 6. Come on, 1 into 10 raised to minus 6, that many meters square, okay. Now simplify, this answer is 1.7 into 10 raised to minus 3, that many volt, okay. Here I could have written capital V, that is symbol for volt, but this V means voltage, that is physical quantity, and here if I write V, it is the unit, okay. So I just wanted to distinguish between that quantity and the unit, so I am just writing the name of that unit in full name. That is volt, okay. Now in 11th standard you had studied about two formula for number of moles of atoms, which were those two formula, mu equals to n upon na and m upon m0. Recall those two formula, mu equals to n upon na and also m upon m0. What is n? Total number of atoms, na means Avogadro number, capital M means total mass of given element, and m0 means atomic weight of that element, atomic weight of that element, got it? If this is atomic weight, this is total number of atoms and this is number of moles of atoms. If this is molecular weight, then this is total number of molecules and at that time this will be number of moles of molecules. Right now we are talking about atoms, atoms of copper, okay. Find out m, come on, transfer this. It will be n into m0 upon na, n into m0 upon na, okay. Now let us talk about density, correct. Normally for density we are giving symbol rho, but rho we are using here for resistivity. I am just using another symbol for density, that is d, d for density, okay. It is mass upon volume, mass already we had shown by symbol capital M, But volume, I am not putting capital V, otherwise you will be getting confused between volume and voltage. Okay? Already V symbol we have used for voltage. So, for volume I am using another symbol V dash. Mass upon volume will give you density. Come on, this V dash as it is. What about formula of mass right now? It is N into M0 upon NA. N into M0 upon NA. Correct? And now, let us find out free electron number density. Free electron number density, it is total number of free electrons divided by total volume. Correct? What about total number of free electrons? Come on, what was capital N? Number of atoms. Total number of atoms was capital N. If the given element has valency P, it means to say its one atom will have P number of free electrons. Correct? If one atom has P number of free electrons, then for such total N number of total atoms, how many total free electrons will be there? N into P. I repeat, this is total number of free electrons. If one atom has P number of free electrons, then for N atoms, it will be N into P. N into P. This will be total number of free electrons. Total number of free electrons divided by total volume will give you number of free electrons per unit volume, which is free electron number density. Correct? Fine. Now, N equals to P as it is. What about capital N upon V dash? Capital N upon V dash. Capital N upon V dash, you can find out from here. It is D into NA upon M0. N upon V dash is D into NA upon M0. Here it is, D into NA upon M0. Correct? And now recall this formula. I equals to A into VD into N into E. Now, A as it is, VD as it is, what about small n? Its formula just now we have obtained PD NA upon M0. PD NA upon M0 into E. Correct? Now, find out VD because we require drift velocity. Make it subject of the equation. M0 will be transferred here. APD NA into E will come in the denominator. Now, put up the values. What about current? They are given 1 ampere. M0 is atomic weight of given element, which is right now copper. Its atomic weight is 63.5 gram per mole. You must convert into kilogram per mole multiplied by 10 raised to minus 3. I have done that. I have multiplied by 10 raised to minus 3. This cross section area, it is 10 raised to minus 6 meter square, or they may give 1 millimeter square. 1 millimeter square is 10 raised to minus 6 meter square. What about P? Valency. Valency for copper, they have given 1. Why I am deriving this formula in general? Because in examination, they may change the element. Instead of copper, they may give you suppose aluminum. At that time, valency is 3. So, they may give you that valency 3. So, at that time, instead of P, you must write 3. Right now, they have given copper, and for copper, the valency is 1. So, instead of P, I am putting 1. What about density? Density of copper, they have given 8.9 into 10 raised to 3 kilogram per meter cube. 8.9 into 10 raised to 3 kilogram per meter cube. By chance, if they give density in gram per centimeter cube, then they will give 8.9 gram per centimeter cube. But you know, 1 gram per centimeter cube is nothing but 10 raised to plus 3 kilogram upon meter cube. For example, density of water, it is 1 gram per centimeter cube, but when you convert it into Mcqs, it is 10 raised to 3 kilogram per meter cube. But here they are given density in Mcqs only, so no problem. But in examination, they give density in gram per centimeter cube. You must convert into kilogram upon meter cube by multiplying with the factor 10 raised to 3. Got it? What about Na? Avogadro number 6.02 into 10 raised to 23 atoms per mole. Correct? What about small e? It is magnitude of charge of 1 electron, 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb. Simplify, this answer is 7.4 into 10 raised to minus 5 meter per second. Okay? Do lot of practice for this particular sum. Okay. Read now number 4. Read it? Come on. We are given one semiconductor. What about semiconductor? I gave you its introduction. Semiconductors are those elements whose electrical conductivity is smaller than those of good conductors, that is those of metals, and more than the insulators, more than the poor conductors. Okay. Such elements are called semiconductors. They have talked about N type semiconductor. There are two types of semiconductors, one is P type, another is N type. Okay. What are P type semiconductor, what are N type semiconductors, that you will be taught in the chapter of electronics in fourth semester. Okay. At present you remember N type semiconductor is that element in which the majority conduction of electricity takes place through free electrons, that is all. Okay. That much you require to know right now. Okay. Now that semiconductor is given to you in the form of a rectangular solid, and that rectangular solid are shown in the figure. Just try to identify different parameters. Look, this is length, right? This much is breadth, this much is thickness or height. Okay. Length I have shown by symbol L, breadth by symbol B, and height by symbol H. Got it? Now, what is given to us in the statement? That battery is connected parallel to the length. Parallel to the length, we are applying the voltage. So, parallel to this length, between these two points, we are applying this voltage. Okay. Now, total current starting from the positive terminal of the battery, let it be I. And that current will pass through the semiconductor in this direction. But you know, direction of flow of electrons is just opposite to direction of electric current. So, electrons will start moving this way, correct? And if free electrons move this way, opposite to this current, then how much time will be taken by one electron to reach from one end to another end? That time we have to find out. We are also asked to find out about electric current density. Let us find out. Recall this formula of I. I equals to A into VD into N into E. Come on. What about A? Cross sectional area. That is true. But now onwards, you just remember very accurately what is A. Not only cross sectional area, it is that cross sectional area which is perpendicular to current, perpendicular to the direction of current. Direction of current is right now this way, perpendicular to that cross section will be this. So, now I should write this as cross sectional area which is perpendicular to direction of current, correct? How much is that area? This measurement multiplied by this measurement. So, it is B into H. B into H will be this cross sectional area, which is perpendicular to direction of current. So, capital A is right now B into H. What about VD? Drift velocity. If any electron starts from here at time t equal to 0, same electron comes here at time t equal to t. In short, it travels this much distance, come on, in time t. So, distance traveled in a specific direction divided by time taken will give you drift velocity, correct? So, VD is L upon t, N into E as it is. Now, find out t from here. Make it subject of the equation, T will be B H L N E upon I. Now, put up all the values, come on, B, breadth, they are given 4 into 10 to the minus 3 meter. What about height or thickness? 25 into 10 to the minus 5 meter. What about length? Length, they are given 6 into 10 to the minus 2 meter. What about N, free electron number density, 10 to the 22 free electron per meter cube. What about E, magnitude of charge of 1 electron, it is 1.6 into 10 to the minus 19 coulomb. What about I, that current they have given 4.8 milliampere converted into ampere multiplied by 10 to the minus 3, correct? This answer comes out to be 0.02 second, that is 2 into 10 to the minus 2 second, got it? Here they may give you total volume. If they give you total volume, then they may not give you this length, because length into breadth into height, length into breadth into height, that will give you total volume of the semiconductor. So, that total volume you can write here and you can find out time. Okay. Breadth and this height or thickness they will have to give, because they are asking also about electric current density, that we will require. Come on, second physical quantity they are asking about electric current density, J equals to by formula I upon A, total current divided by total area which is perpendicular direction of current, correct? Come on. I as it is, cross sectional area perpendicular to current. Cross sectional area perpendicular to current is this area, and it is nothing but B into H. So, this A is, come on, B into H. What about current? They have given 4.8 milliampere converted into ampere multiplied by 10 to minus 3. What about breadth? They have given 4 into 10 to minus 3 meter. Come on, height they have given, or thickness, 25 into 10 to minus 5 meter, correct? From this, you will get the answer 4.8 into 10 is to 3. SI unit of current is ampere. SI unit of area is meter square. So, SI unit of electric current density, we have studied in theoretical part. Come on, ampere upon meter square. Ampere upon meter square. Got it? Here, if they say that voltage is applied parallel to breadth, suppose parallel to breadth, then you will just connect battery across these two points, correct? Parallel to breadth, between these two points, correct? One on this side, one on that side, got it? And then if current is flowing this way, current is flowing this way, then perpendicular cross section will be this. So at that time, length into height will be perpendicular cross section area, remember, okay? If voltage is applied parallel to length, then here length will not come, breadth into height. Voltage is applied, suppose parallel to breadth, then here length into height, got it? Like that, please. Read now statement of example number 5. Read it, come on. Whenever we stretch any metallic wire, the relation between resistance and length, everybody knows now. So far, similar questions we have discussed nearly 3 to 4 times, R proportional to L square. Whenever it is direct proportionality, then apply 1 to 1 to R1 upon R2 equals to L1 square upon L2 square. And now, if original length I assume to be 100 units, then in this case, they have increased the length by 10%. What is 10% of 100 units? That is 10, but that much is increased. So, 100 plus 10, so it is 110, it is a square. Find out now relation between R2 and R1 from here. You will get it R2 equals to 1.21 times R1. Now, find out increase in resistance. Come on, R2 minus R1. R2 is 1.21 R1 minus R1. R1, R1 you can take common, then inside the bracket 1.21 minus 1, that is 0.21. Correct, but because you require increase in resistance in percentage, you must multiply this value by 100%, then it will give you final answer 21% of R1. 21% of initial resistance will be the increase in the resistance, got it? If they ask about percentage increase in the resistance, then you, what you should do, you should transfer this R1 in the denominator, R2 minus R1 upon R1, and then on both the sides you can multiply by 100%. At that time, final answer will be simply 21%, okay? Fine. Read now carefully the statement of number 6. Read it, look, we have one metallic wire of length 1 meter, cross section area suppose capital A, okay. Now what we do, we just cut it and we divide it into two unequal parts, one part I just identify by symbol P, another by symbol Q. This part has length suppose L1, this part has length suppose L2. Now what is given in the statement, that this part, that is wire P, is now stretched till its length becomes double than L1, I am writing 2L1, correct? Whenever you stretch any wire, then what will happen? In the process of stretching, its total volume is going to remain constant. Volume equals to cross section area into length. When A into L remains constant, meaning thereby, if length is getting double, then cross section area will reduce to half, correct? Reduced to half, that is why instead of A, I am putting here A by 2, because when you stretch the wire, not only will become longer, but it will become thinner also, correct? So, now this length I am showing double than L1, I am showing here 2L1, but when length is getting double, cross sectional area becomes half, half of A, I'm writing here A by 2, got it? And by stretching wire P, whichever new wire we have prepared, they have given the symbol capital R in the statement. But remember, this is not resistance, this is the symbol for third wire, okay? Fine. Now, this wire is prepared in such a manner such that its electrical resistance is found to be equal to electrical resistance of this part, that is Q. So, at present, electrical resistance is of part Q and this third wire R, they are given same in the statement. So, I am writing RQ equals to RR. What about resistance of a metallic wire given by formula rho into L by A, that is resistivity into length upon cross sectional area. Resistivity into length, length of part Q. Length of part Q is how much? L2 divided by cross sectional area. For part Q, cross sectional area is capital A, and that equals to resistance of wire R. Again, resistivity into length upon cross sectional area. Resistivity is rho, because type of material for all these three wires it is same, and because type of material is same, the resistivity is constant. What about length? Length of wire R, it is 2L1 and divided by its cross sectional area, which is right now A by 2. So, I am writing A by 2, correct? Now, tell me, rho rho will cancel, AA will cancel, 2 will go up, denominators denominator will become numerator, 2 2 is a 4. L2 equals to 4L1, L2 equals to 4L1. But from this figure we can make out, if you add these two lengths, naturally it should be total initial length, that is 1 meter, correct? L1 plus L2 equals to 1 meter, L1 plus L2 equals to 1 meter, then what is L1 as it is? L2 is 4L1, put it here, L2 equals to 4L1. So, 5L1 equals to 1, then L1 will be 1 upon 5, 1 upon 5, that is 0.2 meter, correct? Put L1 equal to 0.2 meter here, 0.2 into 4, that is 0.8 meter, correct? And you can check, when you add these two lengths, again it is 1 meter, got it? We were supposed to find out the lengths of both the parts P and Q. We have found out, come on, for part P, its length is 0.2 meter, for part Q, its length is 0.8 meter, got it?